Shalom. How are things in North Carolina?
North Carolina, my dad just celebrated his birthday. Hallelujah.
All right.
Katrina's birthday is today. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Ooh, Katrina.
Yeah, Katrina's birthday is today.
Oh, happy birthday, Katrina.
Yay, birthday is today.
Yay.
What a gift. COVID cases are spiking here. The Omicron is becoming more prevalent. I think a lot of people are assuming that they have it versus not when they start having some of the similar symptoms.
Yeah.
I had my manager had mentioned to me she had a negative test, but she had all the symptoms of it. So people
Right.
are not really trusting the testing that they're getting as much, but people are isolating and quarantining, which that's a good thing. So other than that, we are doing pretty good. Boise's doing well. He can speak for
Okay,
himself.
good.
Yeah.
Good, good. That's the one thing that they're saying now, because some of the tests do not pick up this particular variation.
Correct.
So they're telling you if you are symptomatic, assume yes.
Yes.
Okay, and do the necessary things. Okay.
Yes,
And
yes.
that's what we're pretty much doing here in Florida. Another
Right.
reason why our wonderful, wonderful governor, okay, withheld 1 million tests that wound up expiring. So we have a shortage of testing right now.
Oh, wow.
Typical of Florida. Okay, that's Florida.
Wow. Well, we're blessed to have your protocol because when I went back through it and looked at it, things that you'd already told us and things that were added to it, very, very effective. Very effective.
You know, praise God. And nobody but Yah, you know, just puts it in your mind to look at this, look at that, you
Amen.
know. And so you know, he will always lead us and always understand. Brad, do we do Facebook? No, not yet. Okay, Brad, you know, Brad is in control. I'm the pastor, but it's Brad that's in control. Okay, services over here. I'm at his mercy, okay, at his mercy. All right. But yes, you know, always remember our faith once again is in Yah, that we know according to Genesis, when God created everything, he created everything perfectly.
Yes.
Okay. He created the cure before the disease. So
Man.
whenever something new to man comes up, it's not new to God. Okay.
Right.
So there is always, and see, that's why I tell people, you know, when you give something a name, the purpose of giving a name is to reveal the nature.
Yes,
Okay, to reveal the nature. That is why Christians, and I put that in quotes, always bug me when they say, I got this, but I'm not claiming it. I'm not claiming this. I'm not claiming that. And I said, that's exactly what the enemy wants you to do. Because now you will not deal with it according to
come
its
on,
nature.
that's it.
Okay, you will not deal with it according to its nature. So you don't have to claim it because it's already claimed you. It's already claimed you. Now you need to know what to do to get rid of that. And so that's
Amen.
why. I mean, we are so smart. Christians are so much more smarter than Yeshua, because even Yeshua, when the demon-possessed man comes up to him, what does he ask him? What is your
Your
name?
name. Come on.
What is your name? Okay,
Yes.
and see, this one had a spirit of this. This one had a spirit of that. Okay, so we need to stop trying to be so much smart and so spiritual, okay, to
Right.
say, I will run to a doctor a lot of times in a heartbeat. Tell me what the problem is. That's all I need
Yes.
to do.
Yes.
Okay, tell me what it is. I go and study it, and God, okay, this is what we need to do. And I go back to the doctor and tell them, this is what you need to be advising your clients, because they will
Yes.
always go to pharmaceutical first. But God
True.
created the cure before the disease.
Yes.
Okay, and understand that. So there are alternatives to everything, but in the same hand, don't discount
Right.
pharmaceutical
Right.
medications or counter medications,
Right.
because the same God that created that cure and created
Yes.
Adam to have a creative spirit yes. also yes. put certain things in the minds of yes. men to be able to do and give them an understanding. Now, yes. always remember, science is man finding out what God always knew.
Ooh, I love it.
It is progressive revelation. Every time you have a scientific discovery, it's new to man, but old to God.
Mm-hmm.
Old to God, okay? Even pharmaceuticals are what? Imitations of yes. something that God did.
Right, right.
Yes.
And people do not create these things because, oh, they're demon possessed and all of this kind of stuff. No, they're mm-hmm. trying to help somebody.
Right, right.
Yes.
The way they know how. Right. And see, yes. a lot of times, let me tell you, and people get mad at me when I say this, part of the reason why they got to do it is because the church isn't where it needs to be.
Come on.
Okay. We rejected the Torah. We yes. rejected the priesthood. The first yes. doctors were the priests. Adam was the first pharmacist. Noah yes. was a pharmacist.
Yes.
Okay. And so yes. they understood this. So what are we doing? Yeshua says he came to restore that which was lost. Where was it lost? In the garden.
Yes.
In the garden. Okay. So we are going back to the beginning, okay, again, back yes. to the origin of things. Even yes. today in our lesson, we're going to go back to the beginning to get an mm-hmm. understanding of how to roll this forward. And the pattern is always going to be, he reveals the end from the beginning. Mm-hmm. So if you don't understand the beginnings of something, you will not understand the ending of something. Okay, so that is why if you want to know prophecy, you need to look at history, because mm-hmm. the things you did yesterday determine what happens today and going forward. Okay, mm-hmm. so with that, we're going to go ahead and get started. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And Marcia, go ahead and open us up with one of your powerful prayers.
Yes.
Oh, I don't know if she, I needed to check to see if she's available. Can you unmute yourself? There she goes.
Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Father, we thank you for the Shabbat. Thank you, Father, for bringing us once again together, oh God. Father, we are so grateful, oh God, for all that you've done for us, all that you continue to do, and you just continue leading us in the right way, in the right path. Thank you, Father God, for showing us, Father God, how to live, Father God. Lord, we are so thankful for the Torah, thankful for your words, your wisdom, all that you've given us, Father. We thank you again, Lord, for our Pastor Israel, who's, Father God, always on the watch, Father God, and showing us what we need to do, Father God, giving us your word and your instruction, Father God. And Daddy God, we are thankful, oh God, that you are leading us, Lord God, in this fight, in this war, in this mess, oh God, that you are with us, that you will fight every battle for us, and you'll show us what we need to do. Daddy, thank you for your goodness. Father God, I pray for my brothers and my sisters at the yeshiva on the line whereabouts we may be, oh God, that you continually lead us, oh God. Thank you for healing us where we need to be healed and hearing us as we cry out to you, oh God. Father, we are so grateful that you called us, so grateful that you are leading us, oh God. Father, thank you again for your goodness, Lord. In the name of Yeshua, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. All right, Connie.
A question. You said something, I was born and raised in Kojic. And you said, if I'm hearing right, when people say, I'm not claiming that, like I said, they say you have this and you have that. I'm not going to claim that. You're not supposed to say that?
See, when we say we're not going to claim it, have you ever had any of your Kojic brothers, okay, get a diagnosis of diabetes and cancer and stuff, and they don't claim it? Okay. And then you can't come to service because you're going to their funeral. Okay.
I got you. Okay.
He didn't claim that diabetes, and he's in the hospital getting his leg chopped off right now.
Okay, yep. I got you. Okay.
Okay. When they make the diagnosis, okay, understand, a diagnosis is based upon a particular a set of characteristics that something is exhibiting. Okay, so when they look at your body and say your body is exhibiting these particular characteristics, and when we put them all together, this is what it is. Okay, mm-hmm. Yes. And once again, now you know how to deal with it. If I look out the window here, I see cats and dogs. Guess what? I need to know which is which, because you deal with both of them differently. You don't deal with a cat like a dog, or a bird, okay, like a cat or something. So we lose out so much, because how are you going to help somebody through something if they are in denial that the thing even exists?
Okay.
You see what I'm saying?
Yes, I understand.
Okay. Okay. Honey, there you go.
Okay.
Oh, yeah, I'm going to have y'all laughing today. There's a lot of a whole lot of laughing getting ready to go on today.
Shabbat Shalom.
John
19, 31 through 37. Therefore the Jews, because it was the preparation day, so that the bodies wouldn't remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for that Sabbath was a special one, asked the Pilate that their legs might be broken and that they might be taken away. Therefore, the soldiers came, and the broken legs of the first and of the other who was crucified with him. But when they came to Yeshua, they saw that he was already dead. They didn't break his legs. However, one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and immediately blood and water came out. He who has seen has testified, and his testimony is true. He knows that he tells the truth, that you may believe. For these things happened that the scripture might be fulfilled. A bone of him will not be broken. Again, another scripture says, they will look on him whom they pierced. Shabbat Shalom.
Katrina. Shabbat Shalom. Let's not be so fast. Let's go over this minute, because I'm just seeing this. Okay. All right. So first of all, okay, he's crucified, he dies, okay. Verse number 31, it was the preparation, and the body should not remain upon the cross on the Sabbath day, for that day was a high Sabbath. Now, the typical church, in the church, the Sabbath day would have been what? A Saturday. But this Sabbath being a high Sabbath was what? Unleavened bread. So he dies on the Passover because he's the Passover lamb. They want to get him down before sunset. And remember, the 14th is also called the preparation day. So they want to get him down before sundown, because sundown begins what? Unleavened bread. So that sundown, okay, begins what? The first night, night number one, okay, the night number two, okay, night number three, day one, day two, day three, okay, and then you get the resurrection. So this is telling you actually the timing, once again, each and every holy day. So the sundown, okay, a high day would have been Nisan 15. That next day would have been 15, 16. He arises on 17, which is the Sabbath day. Because when we get and we see him resurrected, and they talk about the end of the Sabbath, it's not the end of the high holy day. It's the end of the weekly Sabbath and the beginning of the first day of the week. You see, so if we don't understand the holy days, Yahweh's holy days, you're going to come up with Boise sitting in church wearing a set of rabbit ears. Okay. Rabbit ears and Renee holding an Easter basket. Okay. All right. These are things we need to be teaching people with, that when you come across that, especially your Sunday group. Okay, they need to start getting it right, okay, at this point. All right, next person. Oh, it's Katrina.
Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom. Happy birthday.
Thank you. I'll be reading Acts 13, 15 through 17. Okay. And after the reading of the law and the prophets of the rulers of the synagogue sent unto saying, ye men of brethren, if we have any word of extortion for the people to say on. Then Paul stood up and beckoned with his hand with the men of Israel, and ye that fear Elohim, which audience. Then Elohim and his people of Israel chose our fathers and exalt the people when they were dealt with strangers in the land of Egypt, and with the highest arm brought him. Hold on, let me read that over again. With the highest arm, he that them that out of it, brought them out of it.
Okay. Let's go over that. Verse number 15. And after the reading of the Torah and the prophets, which is what? The law and the prophets, which would be what? The Torah and the half Torah portion. So if that was today, they would be reading Torah portion Bo, and the half Torah would be Jeremiah 46. Now, let me say something. Why is that important? Why is that important for you to know that? Here we are almost 2,000 years later, looking at something the first church did. Now, another thing that is important, when he talks about here, okay, let me see here. Where did you start? Verse number 15? Okay. All right, let me go down. All right. Verse number 16. Then Paul stood up and beckoning with his hand said, men of Israel are who? The Jews. And ye that fear God. The God-fearers are who? The Gentile. Ah, come on now. The Gentiles were where? In the synagogue on the Sabbath day. Those that fear God, now these are ones that are not yet believing in Yeshua. Oh, you don't hear what I'm saying. They are not even believing in Yeshua yet. Yet you are seeing Paul in the synagogue on the Sabbath day, speaking to both Jews and Gentiles who were God-fearers. So when you understand that, it becomes even more important when we get to Acts chapter 15, when he says the Gentiles that are now coming into believers, guess what? He's not talking about those who were already God-fearers that were Gentiles. Now remember, what made them a God-fearer versus a Jew is the fact that they didn't submit to what? Circumcision.
Right.
Because if they were like Cornelius, who was a captain, okay, of the army in the Rome, they couldn't be circumcised, okay? Because then they would have been kicked out of whatever it was. But just like Cornelius was what? He was a God-fearer. He feared God. So whenever you see that term used a lot in the New Testament, those that fear God, they're usually talking about a set of Gentile believers who are doing what? The Noahide commandments from Genesis chapter 8 and 9. It's so important that we know who's who so that you can, let me tell you something. I'm going to tell you this right now. You need to go, all those Sunday people, excuse me, but I'm looking at Paul, and Paul is in the synagogue on the Sabbath day teaching Gentiles. So where are you coming off getting a Gentile church that is separate from the Sabbath day? And what are they reading? The Torah and the prophets. The same thing we are reading today is the same thing that they were reading back here. See, they don't know how to read the book of Acts. And guess whose responsibility it is to teach them? Our responsibility. God brought, oh, come on. God brought us out so that we could in. Come on. He took us out so that we could bring them in. Okay, but it's not your religion. Do it by the word of God. Show them in the word of God. Okay, that these were Gentiles who were in the synagogue on the Sabbath day. So that makes what? Okay, James was saying in Acts chapter 15 in verse number 21, for Moses of old time hath in every city them that preach him being read in the synagogues every Sabbath day. Now, do you understand why James said that? Because they were already in the synagogues on the Sabbath day. And she read, okay, in the book of Acts, they were in Antioch. They weren't even in Jerusalem. They were in the diaspora, and the God-fearers who were believers in Yahweh, all they had to do was what? He's getting ready to talk to them about Yeshua. Guess what? They didn't go out and form some other church. They stayed in the synagogue on the Sabbath day, the same synagogue. You know what? I haven't even had my vitamins today. I'm getting all of this energy from, okay? But anyway, this is some, it's just like God just opened my eyes. How come I never saw this before? You know, how come I never noticed it before? Okay, with this, so this is another validation. When you are talking to those about Acts chapter 15, show them before that. So therefore, James, why did James, okay, James say what he did? That the Gentiles should write unto them that they abstain from pollutions of idols, from fornication, from things strangled, and from blood. These were new people who were former pagans. To bring them in to the synagogue, they had to relieve themselves of pagan ways. God-fearers were Gentiles who had already done that. They were actually following the Torah, okay? They were following the Torah with the exception of circumcision. The males did not get circumcised. So just remember that when you're reading the scripture, it's on who's who. So we see an example here outside of Jerusalem that those in the diaspora where Paul is talking about were already in the synagogue on the Sabbath day. All right, who do we have up next? Let me just scroll back down here. Grace.
Yes. I'll be reading Revelation 8, 6 through 13. And the seven angels, which had seven trumpets, prepared themselves to sound. The first angel sounded, and there followed hail and fire mingled with blood. And they were cast upon the earth, and the third part of the trees were burnt up, and all the green grass was burnt up. And the second angel sounded, and as it were a great mountain burning with fire was cast into the sea, and a third part of the sea became blood. And the third part of the creatures were in the sea, had life, died, and their part and a third part of the ships were destroyed. And a third angel sounded, and there fell a great star from heaven, burning as it were a lamp. And it fell upon the third part of the rivers and upon the fountains of water. And the name of the star is called Wormwood. And the third part of the waters became wormwood, and many men died of the waters because they were made bitter. And the fourth angel sounded, and a third part of the sun was smitten, and the third part of the moon, and a third part of the stars, so as the third part of them were darkened, and the day shone not for a third part of it, and the night likewise. And I behold and heard an angel flying through the midst of heaven, saying with a loud voice, woe, woe, woe to the inhabitants of the earth by reason of other voices of the trumpet of three angels, which are yet to sound. Shabbat shalom.
Shabbat shalom. Guess what he's giving a description of here? What happened when Satan was cast out of heaven? Satan took what? A third part of the angels with him. Remember, a lot of this is symbolism. Remember, seas mean people groups and groups of people. The earth very often means Eretz Israel, okay? And the seas, once again, the nations. The trees represent, okay, Israel. Green grass, the righteous. If you don't understand the symbols, you aren't understanding what's going on here. So what is this saying? Okay, a third part, a third part, a third part. Everywhere Satan touches, what? A third part. Remember, on earth as it is in heaven. Now, let me say something. This with wormwood, chapter, verse number 11. Okay, a third part of the waters become wormwood. Many men died of the war of the waters. Why? Because they were made bitter. I want you to think about this. I want you to think about what's going on in the church today. How many people have been made bitter? How many people are we seeing in the church movements, including the Messianic movement? Okay, are disqualifying themselves because of bitterness. They drank of the waters of bitterness. Okay, so this is a very important chapter, okay, here. And then in chapter 9, it starts talking about, we start talking about a little more, okay, about Hasatan, including the locusts. We forget about the locusts in chapter 9 and the locusts, okay, that are in our this week's Torah portion, as well as the locusts in Joel's second chapter. They are all tied together. All right, we'll get into that a little bit later on. Miriam? Oh, okay, Miriam's reading chapter 9.
Oh, I'm still muted.
No, you're not.
Okay. Okay. Shabbat shalom. This is Miriam from Spring Hill. I'll be reading Revelation chapter 9, verses 1 through 12. And the fifth angel sounded, and I saw a star fall from heaven unto the earth, and to him was given the key of the bottomless pit. And he opened the bottomless pit, and there arose a smoke out of the pit, as the smoke of a great furnace, and the sun and the air were darkened by reason of the smoke of the pit. And there came out of the smoke locusts upon the earth, and unto them was given power, as the scorpions of the earth have power. And it was commanded them that they should not hurt the grass of the earth, neither any green thing, neither any tree, but only those men which have not the seal of God in their foreheads. And to them it was given that they should not kill them, but that they should be tormented 5 months. And their torment was as the torment of a scorpion, and he striketh a man. And in those days shall men seek death, and shall not find it, and shall desire to die, and death shall flee from them. And the shapes of the locusts were like unto horses prepared unto battle, and on their heads were as it were crowns like gold, and their faces were as the faces of men. And they had hair as the hair of women, and their teeth were as the teeth of lions. And they had breastplates as it were breastplates of iron, and the sound of the wings was as the sound of chariots of many horses running to battle. And they had tails like unto scorpions, and there were stings in their tails, and their power was to hurt men 5 months. And they had a king over them, which is the angel of the bottomless pit, whose name in the Hebrew tongue is Abaddon, but in the Greek tongue hath his name Apollyon. One woe is past, and behold, there comes two woes more hereafter. Shabbat shalom.
Shabbat shalom. revealing the end from the beginning. Maybe we'll go over this in a Revelation study. You also have to take this and go back in understanding what's going on in Revelation. Go back to Daniel chapter 11. If you're writing scriptures down, and you can read this a little bit later. Okay, Daniel chapter 11, verses 32 through 35. 32 through 35. Okay, also to understand part of what's going on in Revelation. Remember, Daniel is the book of the end times concealed. Revelation is the book of the end times revealed. When Daniel is told to close the book, and we see in Revelation, Yeshua is told to do what? Open the book that is sealed. Okay, so those two go together. So a lot of what you're seeing in Revelation that's coming to pass was concealed in the book of Daniel. Because remember, in the end, God told Daniel to seal up the book because the time is not yet. Yet Yeshua is handed a sealed book, and only he can open the seals. And after the seals are open, we see all of this stuff going on. So just know that. We'll do that over a study sometime. All right, Hermine.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Oh, good. Okay. Okay. I'm from St. Petersburg, and I'll be reading Revelation 16, 1 through 11. Then I heard a loud voice from the temple saying to the seven angels, "Go and pour out on the earth the seven bowls of God's wrath." So the first angel went and poured out his bowl on the earth. And foul and painful boils came upon the people having the mark of the beast and worshiping his image. Next, the second angel poured out his bowl into the sea, and it became blood like that of a corpse, and every living thing in the sea died. Then the third angel poured out his bowl into the rivers and the springs of water, and they became blood. Then I heard the angel of waters saying, "Righteous are you, the Holy One, who is and who was, because you have passed these judgments, for they have poured out the blood of the Kedoshim and prophets, and you have given them blood to drink. They are deserving." Then I heard the altar saying, "Yes, Adonai Elohei Tzavaot, true and righteous are your judgments." The fourth angel poured out his bowl on the sun, and it was permitted to scorch people with fire. People were scorched with fierce heat, and they cursed the name of Elohim, the one who has power over these plagues. But they did not repent to give him glory. Then the fifth angel poured out his bowl on the throne of the beast, and his kingdom was plunged into darkness. People gnawed their tongues in pain and cursed the Elohim of heaven because of their pains and their boils, but they did not repent of their deeds. Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom. Can you read verse number 5 again?
Okay. Then I heard the angel of the waters saying, "Righteous are you, the Holy One, who is and who was, because you have passed these judgments."
Okay, so what happened to "and shall be"?
Shall be.
See, in the King James, it says, "Thou art righteous, O Lord, which art and was and shall." Remember, Yeshua, same yesterday, today, and forever.
Yeah, it doesn't say this is. This is it the Messianic family Bible.
No. Okay, it doesn't say that. And that's not even in italics. It would be one thing if it was in italics in the King James, meaning it was added. But to take that out, he that was, that is, and was, what about in the future? So you got to be careful, okay, with that. Also, verse number 9, did they use the name Elohim there? Blaspheme the name of Elohim?
No, name of God.
Oh, okay. They said the name of God. Okay, good. Okay. I wasn't sure. All right. So just be aware. A lot of times when you're reading, okay, check the King James Version. Also, the Hebrew Roots versions and what do they call them? Hebrew Names versions sometimes get changed. The scriptures get changed. Yet, what do? We assume because it's the Hebrew names and all of that, that it is right. No, you need to check it because this definitely does not reveal he who was is going to be, who was in the past, will be the same in the future. And that is something important, you know, for the scriptures there, you know, and you definitely don't want to be changing the book of Revelation because he says you change one word. Okay, take out one word. I take your name out of the book of life. So, let's look at that. So always when you're reading a different variation or a different translation, okay, or transliteration even, compare it. That's like we always compare what's going on in the Tanakh with the King James Version also. The reason I like the King James Version, once again, is because especially our keyword study Bible is because it keys to the Strong's Concordance. Very easy to be able to do research and look at the Hebrew. That's what I like about that. Blue Letter Bible is a valuable tool because as you start to study Hebrew, the Hebrew language, you could go in and actually look at the Hebrew and pick out some of the words, okay, begin to read the words in Hebrew also. So for that. All right, great. I just wanted to bring that point in mind, okay, with that. And who do we have next? I think we have, Renee.
Hey, Shabbat Shalom. This is Renee from North Carolina. And I'll be coming from the book of Jeremiah from the JPS Tanakh. And it looks like it is chapter 46, verses 13 through 28. The word which Yahweh spoke to the prophet Jeremiah about the coming of King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon to attack the land of Egypt. Declare in Egypt, proclaim in Migdol, proclaim in Noph and Tophanes, say, take your post and stand ready, for the sword has devoured all around you. Why are your stalwarts swept away? They did not stand firm, for Yahweh thrust them down. He made many stumble. They fell over one another. They said, up, let us return to our people, to the land of our birth, because of the deadly sword. There they called Pharaoh, king of Egypt, braggart, who let the hour go by. As I live, declares the king, whose name is Yahweh Shabaoth, Lord of hosts, as surely as Tabor is among the mountains and Carmel is by the sea, so shall this come to pass. Equip yourselves for exile, fair Egypt, you who dwell secure, for Noph shall become a waste, desolate, without inhabitants. Egypt is a handsome heifer. A gadfly from the north is coming. The mercenaries too in her midst are like stall-fed calves. They too shall turn tail, flee as one and make no stand. Their day of disaster is upon them, the hour of their doom. She shall rustle away like a snake as they come marching in force. They shall come against her with axes like hewers of wood. They shall cut down her forest, declares Yahweh, though it cannot be measured. For they are more numerous than locusts and cannot be counted. Fair Egypt shall be shamed, handed over to the people of the north. Yahweh Sabaoth, the Lord of hosts, the Elohim of Israel, the God of Israel, has said, I will inflict punishment on Ammon of No and on Pharaoh, on Egypt, her gods and her kings, on Pharaoh and all who rely on him. I will deliver them into the hands of those who seek to kill them into the hands of King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon and into the hands of his subjects. But afterwards, she shall be inhabited again, as in former days, declares Yahweh. But you have no fear, my servant Jacob. Be not dismayed, O Israel. I will deliver you from far away, your folk from the land of captivity, and Jacob again shall have calm and quiet, with none to trouble him. But you have no fear, my servant Jacob, declares Yahweh, for I am with you, and I will make an end of all the nations among whom I have banished you, but I will not make an end of you. I will not leave you unpunished. I will chastise you in measure. Wow. Shabbat shalom.
Shabbat shalom. Let's go over that. Okay, verse number 25. All right, where it says, Yahweh Zebaoth, the Elohim of Israel, has said, I will inflict punishment on Ammon of No and on Pharaoh, on Egypt, her gods and her kings, and on Pharaoh and, underline, all who rely on him. Now, why did they get into trouble? Why did they get into trouble? Remember, Jeremiah was a prophet. Jeremiah also prophesied over the nations, okay, about what was going on. We need to go to Jeremiah 44, chapter 44, okay? And remember, this chapter is where, okay, Jeremiah is sitting there and all the people come and say, Jeremiah, go to Yahweh and let him tell us what we should do. Skip down to verse number, 26, okay? Number 26, and hear the word of Yahweh, all Judeans, those who dwell in the land of Egypt. Now, remember what they did. Instead of staying put in Jerusalem, what did they all do? When they came to Jeremiah, they already had their bags packed and were going to Egypt, regardless of what Jeremiah said. Okay, regardless of that. So God responds to them the same way. He goes on to say, lo, I swear by my great name, says Yahweh, that none of the men of Judah in all the land of Egypt shall ever again invoke my name, saying, as Yahweh Elohim lives, I will be watchful over them to their hurt, not to their benefit. And all the men of Judah in the land of Egypt shall be consumed by sword and by famine until they cease to be. Only the few who survive the sword shall return from the land of Egypt to the land of Judah. All the remnant of Judah who came to the land of Egypt to sojourn there shall learn whose word will be fulfilled, mine or theirs. Let me get it reading. And this shall be the sign to you, declares Yahweh, that I am going to deal with you in this place so that you may know that my threats of punishment against you will be fulfilled. Thus says Yahweh, I will deliver Pharaoh Hophra, king of Egypt, into the hands of his enemies, those who seek his life, just as I delivered King Zedekiah of Judah into the hands of King Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon, his enemy who sought his life. See, it was because of this Pharaoh's pride. Remember, Egypt was a world power. Nebuchadnezzar was a new world power taking over. Egypt had been a world power. Assyria had been a world power. But God rose up Nebuchadnezzar, who took over Assyria, who took the northern kingdom, okay? And now, because of the Judeans going down to Egypt, thinking that what? Pharaoh is going to protect us. Even though Yahweh said we are to stay put and we are to do what he said do, we're going down to Egypt, okay? And Pharaoh is going to protect us. So what did God do? He sent that same sword, that same person down into Egypt to take over Nebuchadnezzar. Now, I want you to think about this. Remember in this Torah portion in Exodus, we talked about how the Egyptians were saying they're multiplying too much. And if an enemy comes, they're going to join with us and try to overthrow us. Okay, remember, everything that is taking place, okay, in this already took place in the past. So the very words that that Pharaoh spoke keep on coming back against the nation. Keep on coming back exactly against the nation. This Pharaoh in Jeremiah suffered from the same dis-ease as the Pharaoh in the book of Exodus. They all thought they were smarter than God. They thought they were more powerful than God. So any nation that does exactly the same is what? Going to get the same results. All right, then. Miss Jenny, I guess, Brad, you can start Facebook or whatever. I don't want to tell Brad what to do. He's the boss. Okay, I'm just going to be submissive here and just be quiet and let Brad do what he does.
Shabbat shalom.
Shabbat shalom.
You can count on my readiness to help you.
Yay!
I am ready to help you, so there is no weapon that is formed against you that will be successful. I have established you in my righteousness, and all forms of demonic oppression are far away from you. Don't be afraid of Satan's show of force, because I am with you. I have not given you a spirit of fear. I have given to you all my power through my Holy Spirit. I have filled you with my love, and I have given to you a sound mind. Stand secure in me. Don't be afraid of Satan's intimidation. Don't worry about whether you have enough strength for the battles you must fight. You are my beloved child, and I have blessed you with every spiritual blessing from my place in heaven. I have delivered you from the power of darkness and have translated you into my kingdom, where I will dwell with my dear son. Lord, you are our fortress. We live under your protection and we rest in your powerful shadow. When we are in trouble, we will call out to you and you will answer us with your arm of protection. You will honor us and give us long life with your saving power. Amen. I want to show you what I have for you. Stay in my presence, for I want to show you the blessings that I have for you. Because I love you so much, you have great favor with me, and I give you favor with your fellow man as well. I will anoint your head with oil, and your life will overflow with my blessings. Goodness and mercy will surround your life as long as you live. You will reign in godly power in your life because of the great sacrifice of my son Yeshua for you. Each step you take will be bathed in my divine light, and the blood of my dear son Yeshua has cleansed you from all your sin. No evil will befall you, and no plague will come near your home and family. Stay hidden in my secret place where you are rooted and grounded in my love. Father, because you are our shepherd, we will never be in need. You will lead us along the right paths. If we walk through a valley as dark as death, we won't be afraid because you are with us. Your kindness and love will always be with us each day of our lives. Amen.
Amen. You know you have to make a picture of that and send it to us. Both those days. Let me ask you, in that last prayer, is Psalm number 91 one of the references?
Psalm 23.
Psalm 23. It doesn't have Psalm 91 in there also?
No.
Okay, because I recognize a part of Psalm number 91 hiding in that secret place.
Okay.
You know, yes, I mean, definitely make a copy of that. And okay, I receive that. I claim that. Okay. I definitely claim that. All right. Awesome. Awesome. All right. All right. I think we have who? Lena next.
Shabbat shalom.
Shabbat shalom.
I'll be reading portion summary this week in Bible history and thought for the day. Portion summary, the 15th reading from the Torah is named Bo, which means come. The title comes from the first words of the first verse of the reading, which says, then the Lord said to Moses, come to Pharaoh, for I have hardened his heart. Exodus chapter 10, verse 1. The portion begins by conducting the narrative of the 10th plague, the 10th of which is the slaying of the firstborn. To avoid the plague, the Israelites are given the instructions for the Passover sacrifice, and the laws of the Feast of Unleavened Bread. Pharaoh finally consents to let Israel go, and they leave Egypt. This week in Bible history, winter, Tevet 29. According to Rabbi Judah, cited in the Talmud, Bava Messiah 106b, Tevet 29 marks the end of winter. As per Genesis 8, verses 22, the year consists of 6 2-month seasons: seed time, harvest, cold, heat, summer, and winter. Moses repeats the Torah, Tevet 1:24-88. On the first of Tevet in the year 2488 from creation, Moses convened the Jewish people and began the 37th review of the Torah contained in the book of Deuteronomy, which he concluded on the day of his passing on Adar 7 of that year. Thought for the day: Pharaoh is a pain in the neck. This is how one of the sages, the Aaron, describes the enslavement of ancient Egypt. It is when the mind is entrapped and cannot speak with the heart. It is when you understand well how you should be and what you could be, but your heart does not hear of it and runs wild. So nothing changes. You remain a mindless slave to the moment. Indeed, the Hebrew letters that spell Pharaoh are the same as those for the Hebrew word oref, the back of the neck. Pharaoh stands at the back of your neck and strangles your wisdom. He hijacks your mind, so your thoughts are devoted to building pointless structures up to the sky, chasing ephemeral pleasures, wasting time on nonsense and swelling the ego, not allowing more than a trickle of your higher mind to enter your heart. How will you escape? By bonding yourself to something beyond your own mind and heart, by connecting with an infinite God. Go out and do something good, a mitzvah that feels far beyond your self-image. Forget yourself, the limits of your understanding, the coldness of your heart, wrapped together within the light, utterly beyond them all, mind, body, heart, and soul will surrender and bound in perfect union. Shabbat shalom.
Shabbat shalom. A change in time. Exodus 12 and 2. This month shall be to you the head of months. It shall be the first month of the year to you, the month of Aviv. Now see Exodus 13 and 4. Has been established by Yahweh as the first of the months of the year. This month corresponds with half of March and half of April in the Roman calendar. The word Aviv means green ear of corn. During the Middle Ages, the word was given the meaning spring, as it is used this way in modern Hebrew. During the month of the green grain, in the spring, the people of Israel marched out of Egypt. Aviv is the month of redemption. This redemption is the beginning of Yahweh's plan of salvation. Everything begins with a lamb being sacrificed and its blood redeeming from death. After that came the freedom from slavery. The entire plan of salvation is revealed in the Feast of Yahweh. That is why this month must be the first of the year. Otherwise, the plan is in disorder. If the order of the month is changed, then Yahweh's program for salvation cannot be understood. So we see the month of Abib was around the month of March and April. You know, according to the Gregorian calendar, everything we say is January. And it also shows in April, that's when everything regenerates. It's like new life coming during the springtime. You know, all the old stuff fade away, the new leaves and everything starts to flourish. So that's another sign that we can look at. And the month of March, April also came the beginning of the religious calendar. And that was when it marked the start of Israel being a nation. Now, excuse me. This month is also called the Babylonian name Nisan. You can see in Nehemiah 2 and 1 and Esther 3 and 7. So this is when Aviv began to be called Nisan, and it was after the Babylonian captivity. And you can see that, and like you say, and you can look at Esther 3 and 7, and it kind of explains that. In the Talmud, there's a discussion between two rabbis about whether the world was created in the month of Nisan or the month of Tishri. The second opinion took over, and therefore the year is counted as having begun at the creation of the world on the first of Tishri, which is the seventh month in the biblical calendar. Torah has instituted an annual feast on that day called Yom Teruah, the day of the shout or the day of the alarm. So we call that, you know, the day of trumpets, because the seventh month, and that's around September, October, that is basically considered a sabbatical month because of all the holy days and the feast days that happened during that time. And if you look at it, we have the Feast of Trumpets during that month. We have the Day of Atonement during that month. We have Tabernacles during that month. And we also have, excuse me, the Feast of Booths, which is also called the Feast of Ingathering, and the and it commemorates, you know, Yahweh's provision and his protection and everything in the wilderness. So there was a lot going on during that month. It was a very, very holy month. Now, Christian first of Tishri, where did I leave off? The Torah has instituted an annual feast on that day called Yom Teruah, the day of the shout or the day of the alarm. The Torah says that to you, this is to say to the children of Israel, the month of the Aviv is the first of the months of the year. The expression to you teaches us that it is not this way for others. So this is the way for us. The way for others is, like we know, is January. But like we say, once you come into the fold, there's a covenant, and these are the rules that we have to abide by. So this is not for others. You say, in the beginning, people counted the months from the day of Adam's creation. That's the first day of the first month. When Adam was created on the sixth weekday, he began to count time. To him, it was the first day of the month. This teaches us that Adam was most likely created at the day of the new moon. After that, his descendants continued to count the months and years according to the sun and the moon. See Genesis 1 and 14. Here Yahweh says to you, and by this reveals that it is not this way for others. Others continued counting time as they had before. Before the Exodus from Egypt, the children of Israel did not celebrate the month of Aviv as the first month of the year. But now Yahweh began to put his redemption program into motion. He changed everything, and neither did us. When we was tied up in our Egypt here in America, we didn't celebrate the correct days either. Now, the month that had previously been the first, Tishri, suddenly became the seventh. To you, it is this way, but others are not going to see it this way because they are not part of the great redemption. Exactly. Talmud says, the Hebrew calendar has four new year days. The first day in the month of Nisan, this is the new year for the kings and the feasts. The first of Elul, this is the new year for the counting of the tithe of the animals. The first day in the month of Tishri, this is the new year for the counting of the years, for Shemitah, the Sabbath year, and the year of Jubilee, for planting and agriculture. So the first Shavuot, this is the new year for the trees, according to Shemaiah. In the school of Hill, they say, new years of the trees, the 15th day of the month. The Halakha, the practical law, was established according to Hillel. This is why the new year of the trees is celebrated on the 5th of Shavuot. The names of the Roman months from September to December show us that there is an ancient connection between the biblical way of counting and the Roman way. September corresponds with the seventh month of the Jewish calendar. So October corresponds with the eighth month of Cheshvan. November corresponds with the ninth month of Kislev, and December corresponds with the 10th month, Tevet. Later, the months of the Roman calendar were changed so that they no longer correspond with their names. September is currently the ninth Roman month. In Psalms 104:19, it is written, he appointed the moon for seasons. So the Torah says that we should use the moon as a point of reference when we determine time. And that shows too, if you look at Genesis 1 and 4, it shows you that Yahweh created light and darkness. So before he created the moon and the stars, there was already light. Now he came back and said, okay, now I'm going to create these moons and stars and everything for times and seasons. And of course, man used those for navigation as well. But it was for time and season because light had was already existing if you look at Genesis 1 and 4. And also, this is not only time and seasons for man, but it's time and seasons for animals as well. And I was reading this last night, and I ran across it in Psalms 104, verse 19. So this gives the animals times and seasons. It says, he appointed the moon for seasons. The sun's nose is going down. So everything has a rule to go by. And typically, nobody breaks that but man. He said, you make darkness, and it is night, in which all the beasts of the forest creep about. So the animals know when to come out, their time and season. It said the young lions roar after their prey and seek their food from God. When the sun rises, they gather together and they lie down in their den. So this is time and seasons for them also. So they know now the sun has risen, now it's time for man's season to come out. In verse 23, it says, now man goes out to his work, and to his labor until the evening. So these are all times and seasons, and putting things in order, even in the animal world, and even in all our world, the Lord has order. Now, okay, what did I leave off? A biblical month always begins with the new moon. According to Torah, the first month of Aviv must occur in the spring when the grain is ready to be harvested in the land of Israel. If we only go by the moon year, which is 354 days long and does not follow the course of nature, the spring would not come in the same month every year. And if we go by the sun year, we cannot celebrate the feast according to the moon, as the Torah commands us. We must have a combination of the sun and the moon. In order to compensate for the difference between the moon year and the sun year, in biblical times, they added a month at the end of the year if the grain was not ready to be harvested yet. Now, there was a sacrifice of grain needed for the spring feast, and if there was no grain, the feast could not be celebrated. Until the 3rd century CE, it was the course of nature in Israel that determined when the first month would occur each year. If the spring came late one year, an extra month was added. If the grain was already ready to be harvested at the end of the 12th month, they did not add an extra month. Later, a fixed calendar was established, which was developed by Hill II, year 358 CE, where according to the rules of mathematics, an extra month, Adar 2, is added every other, it was added every other or every third year. Altogether, there are 7 months added in a 19-year period. The biblical year has 360 days. You can see Daniel 7:25, Revelations 13 and 5, Revelations 11, 2 to 3, and Revelations 12, 16 and 14. There is no account in the scriptures saying that an extra month must be added every other or every third year. The Torah does not even take this into account. See Genesis 7 and 11, Genesis 24, Genesis 8 and 3 and 4, and Esther 1 and 4. This gives us a hint that from the beginning, there was no difference between the moon year and the sun year. The moon month was exactly 30 days long, and that way 12 months became a year of 360 days. This meant that the sun only needed 360 days to circle around the earth once. There are archaeological and historical documents from several different ancient cultures that show that there was some type of change in the solar system in the 8th century BCE. There were 5 days added to the sun year at that time. It looks like something happened in our solar system to cause this imbalance between the moon year and the sun year. The earth moved further from the sun and the moon came closer to the earth. There is one event mentioned in scripture that coincides with the time that the ancient document speaks of. We might suspect from the following passage that this was the moment when our solar system was put out of balance, as it is written in 2 Kings chapter 20, verses 8 through 11. Hezekiah said to Isaiah, "What shall be the sign that Yahweh will heal me and that I shall go up to the house of Yahweh the third day?" Isaiah said, "This shall be the sign to you from Yahweh, that Yahweh will do the thing that he has spoken. Shall the shadow go forward 10 steps or go back 10 steps?" Hezekiah answered, "It is a light thing for the shadow to decline 10 steps, nay, but let the shadow return backwards 10 steps." Isaiah the prophet cried to Yahweh, and he brought the shadow 10 steps backwards, by which it had gone down on the dial of Ahaz. Now, this is where time is changing, the shadows and the 10 steps. You know, a lot of times they used to show in the old movies where a lot of the the Native Americans used to look at the moon and the shadows and were able to tell what time it was. So, and this here's explaining about that shadow and the same method where they knew exactly what time of day it was. That's why Christ in the book of John 11 and 9, he was like, "Isn't there 12 hours in the day?" So this stuff was already established. So it's like now we create all the nice jewelry and the Rolexes and think we're creating something and formulating time. And these people have done forgot way more than that than we can learn in our lifetime. Now in Isaiah 38:7-8, it is written, "This shall be the sign to you from Yahweh, that Yahweh will do this thing that he has spoken. Behold, I will cause the shadow on the steps, which is gone down on the dial of Ahaz with the sun, to return backwards 10 steps." So the sun returned 10 steps on the dial whereon it was gone down. Because of this shift, the exact time for the new moon is no longer known ahead of time, since the moon month became 29 days and a half instead of 30 days, as it is probably had, as it probably had been earlier. During King Saul's time, they knew exactly when the new month would occur, as it is written in 1 Samuel 20 and 5. But that really lets you know there was a shift in time, because now they don't know by heart anymore when the new moon is going to occur. You actually got to look and see. David said to Jonathan, "Behold, tomorrow is the new moon, and I should not fail to sit with the king at meat. But let me go, that I may hide myself in the field to the third day at evening." Later on, there were two witnesses needed in order to know when the festival of the new moon would be each month. They could no longer know ahead of time when the annual feast of Yom Teruah ought to be celebrated. Yom Teruah occurs on the first day of the seventh month. No one knows the day or the hour when the new moon of Yom Teruah is visible. This teaches us that the Messiah will come back on Yom Teruah, the first day of the seventh month, as it is written in Matthew 25:13. "Watch therefore, for you do not know the day nor the hour in which the Son of Man is coming." And that's there, you can see the calendar. So with that, say Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom. Plagues of Egypt in the book of Revelation. The biblical concept of judgment is so strikingly illustrated in the plagues of Egypt, based upon the book of Revelation. It is easy to conceive the day of Yahweh as a trial and its execution of judgment as a form of sentence, in which the sovereign ruler and judge sits to hear testimony and pronounces decisions of merit or demerit, of right and wrong. Similarly, it is easy to see in the book of Exodus how Yahweh might have represented as been sitting in judgment upon the idolatries and cruelties of the Egyptians, Pharaoh and all his guilty associates in the oppression of Israel were brought to the bar of God. They stood before the judgment of Yahweh to receive just recompense for their deeds. It is important to note that the Egyptians believed that their Pharaoh to be mediator between gods and the world of men. Pharaoh was considered a god on earth. When he came to the throne, he was instantly associated with the god Horus, the god who had defeated the forces of chaos and restored order. In other words, Horus is the god of creation to the Egyptians. And when he died, he was associated with Osiris, the god of the dead. Pharaoh in ancient Egypt was the political and religious leader. He held two titles, Lord of the Two Lands and High Priest of every temple. So anyway, Pharaoh and his guilty associates, and often the oppression of Israel, were brought to the bar of God. They stood before the judgment seat of Yahweh and received just recompense for their deeds. The essential thought is that God condemns and punishes his enemies and causes his people to triumph. And whether the visitation comes in the form of a flood that drowns out the world, or in a fire and in brimstones such as destroyed the wicked cities of the plains, or in such plague as blighted Egypt, or even today with the current pandemic. In every case, a coming of God to judgment, or if one prefers the other form of the statement, a bringing of both the just and the unjust before the tribunal of the Most High. The Apostle John foretold a future series of plagues that would affect the earth, saying, "Then I heard a loud voice from the temple saying to the seven angels, 'Go and pour out the bowls of wrath of God on the earth.'" Revelation 16, 1. These calamities are symbolically represented by the seven bowls that's found in Revelation 15, 7. Revelation 15, 7. One of the four living creatures gave the seven angels seven golden bowls full of the wrath of God. The seven last plagues are similar to the 10 plagues of Egypt. The seven bowls are similar in many ways to the 10 plagues that took place in Egypt. In Exodus 15, 1 to 12, 30, both affirm the higher authority of God. Both result in the conclusive downfall of those that had rebelled against God, and both illustrate the justice of God in bringing honor to his name. We find in the Haftorah portion this week the judgment of God, and found in Jeremiah 46, 25. It says, "The Lord, the God of hosts, the God of Israel, said, 'Behold, I am bringing punishment upon Ammon thieves.'" This Amun of Thebes is the most important deity in the Egyptian pantheon. He was fused with the sun god Ra, thus becoming Amun Ra. And Pharaoh and Egypt and her gods and her kings, and upon Pharaoh and those that trust in him. So we see, number one, there's judgment against the little g gods. I'm sorry, we see judgment against the big g gods. That would be Amun or Ra. We see judgment against the leaders. We see judgment against the land. Then we see judgment against the small or the little g gods. Those are the ones that are associated with the land, such as the gods of the Nile, the frogs, the earth, and the bulls. We see in America, we have the little g gods of wealth and riches and power and fell and fame. These are all pagan gods, no matter what their name or who they're served, the end result is the same. We've seen recently in the news where the son of a famous man in America noted that the teachings of Jesus have gotten us nothing. So we see the movement in America toward worshiping little g gods and men. Further reading on, the plagues of Egypt were literal punishment that affected the inhabitants' resources and land. They were given to expose the false gods of Egypt and prove their inability to deliver their worships. Exodus 7:17, Exodus 12:2. Similarly, the seven last plagues would be literal. Each one was tracked a different facet of the false religions in the world, and thus have symbolic implications. Since the first redemption is similar to the final one, we can find similarities in the plague that came over Egypt and the plagues that will come over the world in the last days. So if we want to see what's coming, let's look to the past to see what happened in Egypt. We're going to compare the plagues that came over Egypt with those found in the book of Revelation. Number one, we have water turned into blood, Exodus 7, 14 to 25. In Revelation 8, 8 and 6, 13, it is written, "The second angel sounded, and something like a great burning mountain was thrown into the sea. One third of the sea became blood. The second angel poured out his bowl into the sea, and it became blood as of a dead man. Every living thing in the sea died." Number two, frogs, Exodus 8, 1 through 15, 7, 26 through 8, 11. In Revelation 6, 13 through 14, 16, 13 to 14, it is written, "I saw coming out of the mouth of the dragon, out of the mouth of the beast, and out of the mouth of the false prophet, three unclean spirits, something like frogs, and they are spirits of demons, performing signs, which go forth to the kings of the whole inhabited earth to gather them together for war on that great day of the God of God Almighty. So we'll see in the future when this thing goes forth, there'll be spirits speaking to the kings of the earth, telling them to go forth. Just as spirits speak to the kings of the earth now and tell them to do that certain things that are evil and against God. Number three, swarms of life, Exodus 8:16. That's found in Revelations 9:1-11. Number four, wild animals, as Exodus 8:20-32. In Revelation 6:8, it is written, and behold, a pale horse, and he sat on, and his name was Death. Sheol followed with him. Authority over one fourth of the earth to kill with sword, with famine, and pestilence by wild animals of the earth was given to him. Number six, pestilence of cattle. That's Exodus 9:1-7, and in Revelation 6:8b, as it is written with pestilence. Number six, you find boils, Exodus 9:8-12. In Revelation 16:2, it is written, the first went and poured out its bowl into the earth, and it became harmful and evil sore on the people who had the mark of the beast, who worshiped his image. Number seven, hell, Exodus 9:13-35. In Revelation 16:21, it is written, great hailstones about the weight of a talent. The weight of a talent is supposedly around 75 pounds, some say possibly 100 pounds. So we find hailstones coming down weighing 75 to 100 pounds. It came down out of the sky to the people. The people blasphemed God because of the plague of the hail. But the hail is exceedingly severe. So the hail was so severe, the people blasphemed because of the plague. Number eight, locusts, that's Exodus 10:1-20. In Revelations 9:1-11, it is written, the fifth angel sounded, and I saw a star from the sky which had fallen on the earth. The key to the pit of the abyss was given to him. He opened the pit of the abyss, and smoke went up out of the pit, like the smoke from a burning furnace. The sun and the air were darkened because of the smoke from the pit. Then out of the smoke came forth locusts on the earth, and power was given to them, as the scorpions of the earth have power. They were told that they should not hurt the grass of the earth, neither any green thing, neither any tree, but only those people who don't have God's seal on their forehead. They were given power not to kill, but to torment them for five months. The torment was like the torment of a scorpion when it strikes people. In those days, they will seek death, and it will in no way find it. They will desire to die, and death will flee from them. The shape of the locusts was like horses prepared for war. On their heads was something like a golden crown. Under the faces were like people's faces. They had hair like women and teeth like those of lions. They had breastplates like breastplates of iron. The sound of their wings were like the sound of chariots and the many horses rushing to war. They have tails like those of scorpions and stings in their tails. They have power to harm men for 5 months. They have over them as a king, the angel of the abyss. Name in Hebrew is Abaddon, but in Greek, his name is Apollyon. Number nine, darkness, Exodus 10:21-29. Also Revelation 6:12, 8:12, and 16:11. It is written, I saw when you opened the sixth seal, there was great earthquake. The sun became black as sackcloth made of hair, and the whole moon became as blood. The fourth angel sounded, and the one third of the sun was struck, one third of the moon, and one third of the stars, so that one third of them would be dark, and the day wouldn't shine for one third of it, and the night in the same way. The fifth poured out his bowl on the throne of the beast, and his kingdom was darkened. They gnawed their tongues because of the pain. What's plague in Egypt? The 10th plague.
The what's plague in Egypt is your homework assignment. This was actually put to by Bertha, okay, and her group up in Detroit years ago. I think about 7 or 8 years ago. Okay, so it's a good homework assignment, okay, for you to go over and look at the scriptures and everything that they came up with that. I thought it was very unique, so I thought I'd just go ahead and include it. I'm going to share a screen for a minute. Let me ask you something. Have you ever heard that the word, when we were talking about in Jeremiah 46, Ammon, the god of the Egyptians, okay, one of the gods of Egyptians. Have you ever heard that when you say the word amen, that you are really referring to the Egyptian god Amun? And some people will not say amen because, you know, it's referring to, you're really referring to this god of Egypt. I don't know if any of you have ever heard that before. All right, some of you have heard that before. Okay, so let's dispel all of that. When people come up and say stuff like that, here's what you're supposed to do. Bobblehead. Okay, all right. Because they obviously don't know anything about Hebrew or what they are talking about. Okay, so bobblehead, you can practice that on your own time, okay? But in the meantime, we're gonna go, I'm gonna share a screen. Let's see here. Blue Letter Bible. Okay, I'm bringing up the Blue Letter Bible, okay, so that you can see this. So I'm going to put in the word amen, A-M-E-N, and let's hopefully, my internet is acting correct. All right, so we see scriptures here, Numbers 5:22, and we know that that is the... once again, that unfaithful bride. So the word amen, amen, that we typically use is Strong's number H543. So let's click on H543 to see what amen means. So amen, once again, it's an adverb, root word from 539, but let's see what it means. Okay, in this case, verily, truly, so be it. Okay, so if you don't feel comfortable with amen, you could say so be it. However, once again, this is not a root, it's an adverb. So there is a root word associated with that. That's Strong's number H539. So whenever you're doing a Bible study, this is why I like the keyword, rather the Blue Letter Bible. Because it's very easy for you to do Bible studies because they reveal the information. You always want to go to the root word, find that root. So that's from a word, amen, or amen, amon, okay? And what does that mean? The root word means what? To support, to confirm, to be faithful. Faithful. Is that not a reason why you say amen, amen, so be it? So be it, whatever God says, so be it. Faithful, okay? To be established, to be faithful, to make firm, okay? To trust, trust, all right? Trust is associated with what? Truth. Trust is associated with truth. So what I'm gonna do up here is put in the word truth, T-R-U-T-H, oops, sorry. Truth. Okay, and we know the word truth, when it comes up, we know that that is the word, okay, emet. Emet, Strong's number H571, emet. However, this is also what? An adverb, meaning it is not a root word. So it says contracted from Strong's H539. So we click on to see what the root word means. And the root word is what? To support, to be fruitful, amen, okay? So the word truth is associated with the word amen. The word amen can be translated as so be it. It is something that is faithful. It is something that you can put your support on, okay? Your support, it is true. It's something that is established, that is firm. So when you are saying amen, that is a fact, okay? In other words, you're saying that is a fact, that is truthful, okay? So don't be fearful of, you know, saying certain things. Research it for yourself. Don't just assume that people are right a lot of times. That's why we do the study that we do, so that you can search it out, but search it out with valid information, okay, yourself, and not something that someone else is coming up with, you know, and then go through and see how the word is used in scripture. The first use of that word is Genesis 15:6. And he believed in Yahweh and he counted it to him for righteousness. Who's that? Abraham. So the faith of Abraham, he believed, he amen in Yahweh, and he counted it to him for righteousness. Okay, so, you know, look and do a word study on that. Always do word studies so that you get that in your spirit, so that when you hear craziness, like some people have sometimes, you don't go for the craziness, because you know what the truth is. And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall what? Make you free. All right, I'm gonna stop sharing. Okay, we'll go back to that later on. So I'm gonna kind of start from kind of backwards in my notes, because as I was writing today, this I got at 9:55 a.m., kind of secrets of the kingdom and kingdom rule, okay, as I was contemplating, okay, a lot of this. Now, here's something, thought, yes, what do you want, little dog? I got two little dogs here that keep on bugging me, okay? They want some treats, but it's not time for treats. Anyway, when you dehumanize or demonize someone, the way God's justice works is that your fear is a lie, but your fear will eventually manifest itself in some sort of truth. Remember what the word says, your fear, that which you fear will come upon you, okay? So things that we fear, sometimes we are fearful of stuff that doesn't even exist. We're believing a lie. Remember how we started this Torah, this whole book of Exodus, in the lie, okay, lies, crimes, and cover-ups. The first thing Pharaoh had to do, listen to what I'm saying, because the more things change, the more they stay the same. And when you understand these laws of the kingdom, you will begin to recognize them when you hear them, even now. So the first thing that Pharaoh had to do, Pharaoh was a person that was put into the most powerful position on the earth, a leader of the earth. The first thing he had to do was instill fear of one group of people against those that he was in leadership of. And guess what? Those people that he instilled the fear about were what? Immigrants. Oh, you're not hearing me. Okay. They were not like the people in the land. In other words, they were not Egyptians. They were people that were outsiders. So the first step in dehumanizing someone or demonizing someone is to get you fear that particular group of people. All right? You understand what I'm saying? Some of you are getting it. All right? However, your fear is a lie. And eventually, that lie is going to manifest itself in some type of truth eventually, not just for the one who's spreading the lie, but for the ones who are believing the big lies. Okay. Now, let's see here. I have, okay. What you fear, you will dehumanize or demonize and treat them according to the way you created for yourself as justification. So whatever you fear, you will dehumanize, you will demonize, and then you will begin to treat them the way you are seeing them, okay, and using that for your justification. So if you see someone as disgusting, how are you going to treat them? Disgusting. You'll believe the lie. So you will begin to treat them according to the lie you believe. Okay, laws of the kingdom. Okay, now, remember how we started in Exodus chapter 1. Pharaoh's describing, and all of this, you got to understand this, because this is the key to understanding the plagues. Where purpose is unknown, abuse is inevitable. If you don't understand the purpose of the plagues, you won't recognize what Yahweh is doing. And guess what? Oh, let me tell you something. When you really get this, you'll start laughing. Because when people do stuff to you, you'll start laughing. And they'll be thinking, oh, I better leave them alone because they're going crazy. No, I'm not going crazy, but I know how this thing is going to end. Because I've seen the beginning of how Egyptians treated the Israelites and how they wound up because of how they treated them. Let me tell you something. You will begin to laugh at your enemy. You will begin to understand how you will see the reward of the wicked with your very own eyes. You will understand why you will allow vengeance is mine, says Yahweh. I will repay. You can walk away from that situation laughing. Instead of stressed out. Oh, come on now, stressed out about it. Okay, so now, Pharaoh's describing the Israelites to his people as multiplying, okay, as a multiplying disgusting swarms who would eventually overtake them and leave them, eventually manifested in the plagues. Now, see, this is why I need you guys a lot of times when I talk about studying the Hebrew. It's getting to the, you know, to the point where you're able to begin to recognize the words, able to do the word studies on them and understand, okay, understand the language that they are using, okay, that they are using there. Because when Pharaoh began to say they are what, multiplying, okay, they're going to overtake us. The language in the Hebrew that he used to describe them was something that was disgusting, something that we needed to get rid of, something that we didn't need to have around us. Okay, they demonized the Israelites to what? Remember, what you dehumanize and what you demonize, you will eventually find a way to destroy. Based upon how you are seeing them. But remember, what you are seeing is a lie, is a lie. Okay, so what did they wind up doing? They eventually just used that as justification to do what? Break the Israelites. They wanted to destroy them. They wanted to break them physically, mentally, emotionally, and spiritually. Okay, so on all those realms was the plan of Pharaoh, and Pharaoh's plan was what? Based upon a lie. Why? Because there arose a Pharaoh who didn't know Joseph. So therefore, if he didn't know Joseph, he didn't know who he was messing with. Now, let me say something to you. The exact same spirit is alive and well today. When Pharaoh would not acknowledge the history of the people in his midst, he began to deal with them in a certain way. When he did not know Joseph or Joseph's people, he did not recognize Joseph's God or the people that belong to God. You see what, when people come to try to erase your history and not acknowledge your history, get ready. God is about to begin to deal. The very things they begin to fear about you are going to start manifesting on them. Okay, so we're laying a foundation here. Now I want you to think about this. Every way they demonized the Israelites came back to them in a way that did what? Destroyed them, what? Physically, mentally, emotionally, and spiritually. All of the plagues, okay? Let's see. So when and if, something to know, when and if someone cannot manipulate you, they will try to demonize you. Remember what Pharaoh did. He used subtlety he used subtlety against the people of Israel. In other words, once again, the Israelites were very peaceful. They were very helpful. Oh, we've seen that in the history of this country. People came over here and the Native Americans did what? Help them. Very peaceful. And how were they repaid? They were demonized. And the very ones that demonized them went out to do what? Destroy them. We've seen this pattern in this country. Now, guess what? The very history of that is now being disclaimed and not taught. So what are we trying to do in this country? Lies, crimes, and cover-ups. Lies, crimes, and cover-ups. All right, now. So when somebody wants to demonize you, when you become demonized to them, they will attempt to project their fear of you on others and demonize you to others. You understand what I'm saying? All right. So now, Yahweh could have just taken his children out of Egypt and that was it. Okay. But before a physical, remember this, please remember this, before a physical redemption, and that is the Israelites leaving Egypt in the Exodus, there also had to be a redemption of the pain and suffering, okay, by God, which was to demonstrate to the Israelites that God was aware of everything that had been happening to them at the hands of the Egyptians, okay, at the hands of the Egyptians. Now, if you roll it forward, even to every nation, in the prophets, when we were going over, okay, the nations in Revelation study in Amos, everything that those nations or people did to Israel wound up coming back upon them. You understand what I'm saying? So this establishes a pattern for the kingdom. Right now, people need to be saying, ruh-roh, okay, we got troubles in River City, okay, Music Man time, we got troubles in River City, okay, right now. So anyway, lies, crimes, and cover-ups, we're doing the same thing today by not allowing history to be taught, covering it up. Just like in Texas, they wanted to take out the Holocaust. Well, actually, they said, we'll teach it, but we're going to teach alternative theories to the Holocaust also. However, we're going to remove all history of slavery and Jim Crow and all of that. We want to never teach that again. So they're going through taking out even those references in the history books now, not allowing teachers to teach them. We got big trouble in River City, guys, okay? Because the same patterns that we are seeing, okay, in the Bible in Egypt are the same patterns we are seeing today. And if you go to Washington, D.C., you see a whole lot of Egypt in Washington, D.C., on our money, on our capital, okay, and everything like that. So let's continue. All right, we've talked about the Nile going backwards, okay, forward to go backwards and backwards to go forward. Okay, we talked about a new insight about the Nile. They took the Hebrew babies and did what? Threw them in the Nile, okay? Big cover up, use the Nile as a cover up, okay? Then after that came the frogs, right? Remember, frogs were representative of the goddess of fertility. They threw the babies in the Nile, turned the Nile to blood, out comes frogs representing the goddess of fertility. You threw our babies in, what came out? Okay, you got to start seeing this, okay, as to what is going on, okay, with this. All right. And so what did you do? The Egyptians killed the Israelite babies. Out come the frogs. The frogs die. So the smell of death, that same death that you put upon the Israelites, is now making a stench in your own houses. Why? Because all of Egypt contributed to the killing of the babies. All right. Now, listen. Pharaoh didn't just turn the people into slaves. He used deception to remove their wealth, their independence, and their freedom. Now, the big insight with this was, oh my God, the Joseph factor. The Joseph factor. What did Joseph do to remove the wealth from the Egyptians and enslave them in Genesis? Remember, at the end of Genesis, the Israelites were free and the Egyptians were the ones that were enslaved. So what does Pharaoh do? That Pharaoh who doesn't know Joseph, he reverses everything that Joseph did. So by the time we open up in Exodus, get to the end of Exodus, the Israelites are enslaved exactly the way the Egyptians had. But what did Joseph use to do that? Remember, he used taxation. He taxed them. Remember what else Joseph did? He confiscated their land. What else did Joseph do? He made them indentured servants so that they were working for the government, enslaved to the government. So by the time we open up in Exodus, we are seeing the exact same things that happened in, I think it is Genesis chapter 47, only this time the subtlety is with the Israelite people, whereas before it had been with the Egyptians. Okay. So everything that happened to the Egyptians, okay, happened to the Israelites under a Pharaoh who did not know Joseph. And that word Joseph, or rather that word know, Strong's number 3045 is yada, to know intimately, to have more than an acquaintance with. Okay. So continue here now. Just going over, getting up to where we are right now. We're going to go a little bit over. Okay. The Egyptians stole the babies like what? A thief in the night. They came in and they used the Nile to do what? Cover up the crime. And I need you to understand that when you're looking at the plagues, there is a reason why God chose each plague and the sequence of those plagues. So the last two plagues were what? The death of the firstborn and darkness. The death of the firstborn, if we take it backwards, death of the firstborn, darkness, and locusts. Locusts were what? The economy. The darkness, once again, in the Egyptian's house, okay, and the death of the firstborn in the Egyptian's house, maybe the Egyptians came into the Israelites' houses, stole the babies out of the house at night, which is why Yeshua says, okay, he talks about like a thief in the night, do not be unawares, because the enemy is going to come in like a thief in the night. A thief in the night. Okay. Now, what we start seeing is, what do you do when nature begins to rebel against you? Why the Nile? Nile was the most important river in Egypt. Am I right? But the Nile, okay, was created by God and it watered the Garden of Eden. So the Nile was created by God. How long did you think that creation was not going to do what? respond to being defiled. Respond to what being a murderer, used as a murderer, to murder innocent blood. What do you do when nature begins to rebel against you? That's what we're seeing in the book of Revelation also. Okay, so the Nile was one of the rivers that God created in Genesis chapter 2 with Eden. It watered Eden, the Garden of Eden. It's a great river. All right. And so what do you do when nature strikes back and reveals the crimes were perpetrated against it by you? All right. So they defiled the Nile by the murder of innocent blood. Remember, in Deuteronomy chapter 21, verses 7 through 9, if a body is found in a field, the elders of the city have to come out and what? Swear, we had nothing to do with this. And what do? Pour water on their hands, okay, washing them, saying we had nothing to do with this innocent blood. All right, so we see that principle revealed to that, okay? So they defiled the Nile by the murder of the innocent blood. The rivers turned to blood, okay? It is the blood, or rather the Nile doing now, testifying against the Egyptians. And guess what? Even the frogs testified against them, using their goddess of fertility, representing the babies. Listen, this would not have been lost on the Israelites because they understood which gods were represented by every single plague. God was showing the Israelites, I have seen what they did to you. And so the same plague in exactly the same areas that they did to you, causing you pain, are going to be the same areas that I will use to cause them pain. They use creation against you. I am the creator. The creator obeys my will. So the very creation was now used to testify against them. And out of the mouth of two or three witnesses, let every word be established. So now we had talked about the frogs. Okay. So think about it. Remember how we said that they described the Israelites as swarms, nasty swarms that needed to be destroyed. Okay. So they took those babies, okay, and swarms, and threw them into the Nile, okay? And what came out? Swarms of frogs against them, all right? And the frogs stank, okay? The frogs stank, okay? Now, remember what the Israelites also said. Remember how I said, you can be oppressed so long that you begin to see yourself through the eyes of your oppressors. We kind of call that Stockholm syndrome today, where you will begin to what? Venerate your oppressor, okay? Revere your oppressor. So what do the Hebrews say? The Hebrews said in Exodus 5, 21, Moses, you made us stink to the Hebrews, to the Egyptians. You stink and look disgusting to the Egyptians. It was Pharaoh that looked at the Israelites and told the Egyptians, when you look at them, they are disgusting. They are so disgusting. They begin to see themselves through the eyes of their oppressors. Guess what? No different today. Okay, no different today. Because we can look at each other and what? Hate on each other. Seeing ourselves through the eyes. We don't want you to succeed. That's not you saying that. That is years of indoctrination trying to be like that one who oppressed you. Come on. Now, the plagues okay, made them come to a realization. The Egyptians, the plagues made the Egyptians come to a realization of their crimes against Israel. Okay, and you know they recognize that through this week's Torah portion in Exodus 10, where the servants of Pharaoh come to say, Pharaoh, don't you recognize that Egypt is lost? Don't you recognize that Egypt is lost? Pharaoh saying, I have sinned. My people have sinned. We need to change this thing. Okay? Don't you realize that Egypt is lost? So they begin to recognize that. But then, oh my God, Yahweh has Moses deal with Pharaoh in a way he didn't deal with him before. And this was what was blowing my mind. Okay, just blowing my mind. This week, okay, remember, when Moses first rolls up in Egypt and goes to Pharaoh, let my people go that they may come and serve me. Yahweh says to let my people go. How does Pharaoh respond? Oh, no, no, Yahweh, y'all better get the heck on up out of here. Okay. So, oh, please, let us go in 3 days. Let us go worship for 3 days at your permission. Okay, let us go worship for 3 days. Okay, so Moses comes in very nicely. I'm asking you. In this week's Torah portion, we see a turn of events. Moses rolls up on Pharaoh. Now, didn't come until after Pharaoh and his courtiers' confession, acknowledging that Yahweh is creator. Moses rolls up on Pharaoh and says, how long before you humble yourself to me? And Pharaoh gets stubborn. What clicks in on Pharaoh? Pride. Pride. Because Pharaoh was the supreme God. And let me tell you something. I was sitting, and God is my witness. I'm sitting in my living room, okay, studying this last night. And I heard a line from Charlton Heston's, okay, the Ten Commandments. Do you remember there was a scene where Yul Brynner and his queen were sitting together and she was really egging him? Are you going to allow the God of slaves over you, Pharaoh? And I said, oh my goodness. Pharaoh couldn't relent because am I going to let the God of these slaves tell me what to do? So Pharaoh does what? Exactly what the Bible says. Pharaoh made his heart stubborn again. And said, okay, if you're going to go, who's going to go? I'm still going to be in charge. Who's going to go? And he says, hey, we're all going to go. No, you aren't. This is who's going to go. No, you aren't. And those are not acceptable terms. Next plague. See, remember, the first plagues were education. To show them, I am education for the Egyptians. Once again, what was he trying to show them? There is none like me in all the earth. The earth is Yahweh's, okay? You know, so it was all about educating the Egyptians as to who Yahweh was, who he is. They finally admit he is creator. They finally admit, Pharaoh admits he has sinned. But now his pride comes in because everybody's looking at me. I can't let these people go. I can't let them acknowledge that the God of slaves is greater than I am, who is the most powerful man on all the earth. So if you're going to leave, it's going to be on my terms for me to let you go. And that's why when Pharaoh made his heart stubborn, he made his heart stubborn. We see Yahweh saying, I have hardened his heart. But we remember that word hardened meant to strengthen. Pharaoh already was not going to once again let the people go. So with each plague, he began to relent. And Yahweh said, let me strengthen your heart, because you still don't want to let these people go. I don't want it to be known, okay, that I forced you into this. Pharaoh, I'm giving you the opportunity to do the right thing on your own accord. Do the right thing. Now, where do we see that model? Leviticus chapter 26, where Yahweh says, as this happens, okay, and if you don't turn it around, then something seven times more. And if that doesn't make you change, I'm going to send something seven times more. So with each plague, God was giving the Egyptians and Pharaoh the opportunity to repent and do the right thing. But when you have it in your heart that you are not going to do the right thing, there is no plague great enough that is going to force you. Hello? You seeing anything like that today? Yep. Okay. So the plagues reveal more than just God bringing Egypt to its knees or showing that he is creator or even the master of the universe. But the plagues, this is how you go into this. The plagues show the Israelite that God saw the way that they were treated. It saw the way that God saw the way that you treated my child, how you tormented him, okay? How you almost destroyed them. And is showing them that he can redeem them by bringing all the abuses of the last 210 years to light for all to see. Because it wasn't only Egypt that was seeing the plagues. It was every nation around that was seeing what was going on in Egypt and how Egypt was being brought down in front of the entire world. How all of Egypt's pride and their systems of support were being nullified because of how they treated certain groups of people in their midst. Hello? Do I drop the mic now or do I keep on? I'm going to keep on, okay? You think about it. Because the more things change, the more they stay the same. Okay, now, the purpose of the plagues to Egypt was to teach them that there is one God who is creator, the master of all the various forces of nature. Education. And we saw that Exodus 9:14, there is none like me in all the earth. Exodus 9:29, the earth is Yahweh's. Exodus 8:6, going a little bit better. That you may know that there is none like Yahweh, our God. All right, so we see all of that. Exodus 8:18. Okay, that you may know that I, Yahweh, am in the midst of the land. So God gives them all of this to educate them as to who he is. So that through Egypt, the entire world would know about Yahweh. You understand that? All right. Now, in Exodus 9:27. The end of the seventh plague, Pharaoh recognized the truth. However, when Pharaoh changed his mind, he turned his back on the truth. What does Yahweh say about that in 2 Thessalonians? Because you refuse to believe the truth, God will send you a strong delusion that you will believe a lie. Okay? And what does he do? Bring destruction and damnation upon them. So we see the very principle in Exodus taught to us by Paul thousands of years later, okay, in the epistle of the 2 Thessalonians, okay? So anyway, Pharaoh turns his back on the truth, okay? It's like he didn't care. Okay, he didn't care anything about God, the education. And at that point, God stops educating him. Why? Because he already got his point across. The first plagues, okay, after that seventh plague, Pharaoh admitted, God, you are creator. So there's no more time for education. You already know who I am. You want to know what the truth is. You just refuse to believe it. You refuse to act on that truth. So at that point, there is no more education. It is now about retribution. Oh boy, hello. Oh my God, I get a headache thinking about it. So the purpose of the plagues, okay, to Egypt, or rather to Israel, once again, Exodus 10 verses 1 through 3. Let's go to Exodus 10 verses 1 through 3. I'm going to go about 15 minutes over. This is too good. All right. Exodus 10 verses 1 through 3. Then Yahweh said to Moses, go to Pharaoh, for I have hardened his heart and the hearts of his courtiers in order that I may display these my signs among them, and that you may recount in the hearing of your sons and your sons' sons how I made a mockery of the Egyptians and how I displayed my signs among them. Why? In order that you may know that I am Yahweh. So these lessons now are directly directed to show the Israelites, all chance of education is over. Okay, now I'm lowering the hammer on them for what they did to you. The Israelites were slaves. Oh, you don't hear what I'm getting ready to say. They built the economy of Egypt. They built the economy of Egypt. What did the plague of locusts do? Destroyed the economy of Egypt. Destroyed the economy of Egypt. Okay, you need to understand. Measure for measure. Remember, the Israelites came into the land willingly and were made slaves, okay? And were made slaves within that land, okay? Now, so we see that in that there. So the purpose of the plagues was for Israel to know that he is Yahweh. And that is how you will begin to know or experience him. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob knew me by the name of El Shaddai, but by my name Yahweh, they did not experience. Now, Israel, you are going to experience the power of Yahweh when I redeem you, not only out of Egypt, but redeem every single pain that you have experienced in the land of Egypt when I bring my retribution against those that caused you that pain. Now, let me say something to you. Moses went into Egypt after the Pharaoh he knew had died. So these Egyptians were not the ones that originally enslaved, okay, the Israelites, but they were ones who were benefiting by what the previous people had done. They were benefiting by the system that was put in place by those other pharaohs. Oh, you don't hear what I'm saying, or some of you do hear what it is I am saying. And that excuse, it wasn't me, that excuse did not matter because they still did what? Oppressed the Israelites. They used their privilege as Egyptians to oppress the Israelites. Hallelujah. What did Yahweh say to Pharaoh, how long will you refuse to humble yourself before me? That is the question, okay, that I will ask every elected official. How long before you humble yourself before the God of this nation, the creator of the heavens and the earth? Now listen, sometimes it's not what you say, but it's how you say it and who you say it to that matters. Okay, when Pharaoh and Moses got together in this Torah portion, Moses wasn't playing with Pharaoh. And what did God say before to Moses? I have made you as a God to Pharaoh, and Aaron is your prophet. So Moses was speaking directly the words from the mouth of God. How long before you humble yourself before me? Gloves are off at this point. Gloves are off at this point. Okay, so how did Yahweh make Pharaoh stubborn? He insulted him. He insulted him. Pharaoh considered himself a supreme deity to himself and to his people. It would have lessened how he looked to the people he ruled if he backed down to the God of the slaves. Oh, come on, Holy Ghost. So Yahweh appealed to Pharaoh's ego and Pharaoh's pride, and that made Pharaoh more stubborn. He found the strength to become stubborn. Okay? Pharaoh had already realized that that he was merely a creation and that Yahweh was a creator in that seventh plague. So what Yahweh said, he said it in front of Pharaoh's servants. So what does Pharaoh have to do? Save face. Because the servants are now coming to him. Don't you know that Pharaoh, that Egypt is lost? Moses went away. The servants say, don't you know that Egypt is lost? So they bring back Moses in front of Pharaoh. Who brought him back? The servants did. The servants, his servants. Okay, this time. And now we begin the negotiations. Okay, well, who's going to go? How are they going to go? How long are they going to go? No, they're not going to go. Okay, you up to mischief again. And so what does Pharaoh do? Moses says, no problem. Locust. Okay, locust. All right, and locusts come and destroy the land. Pharaoh does what? He relents again. Oh, I'm so sorry. All right. Okay. Okay, you can go, but you're going to leave your cattle here. What you still negotiating for? And Moses says, no. Not only will we take our cattle, we're going to take all of yours too, because we don't, Yahweh is going to have us to need to worship him. And what does Pharaoh do? Oh, heck no. Okay. His pride does what? Again, this time, Moses don't even tell him about the darkness. Okay. Because you darkened your eyes and could not see him. He darkened the ground. The ground was dark. You couldn't see the ground for all of the Pharaohs. Now we're going to darken the sky. So when you look up, you saw darkness with the locusts. When you look up, all you're going to see is darkness now because you refuse to humble yourself. You won't see Yahweh. Well, you won't see at all. You won't see at all. Okay, now. Remember how they said the Israelites were multiplying like swarms also. And those swarms would join together with an army. Important you understand that. Locusts in the prophets are described as God's army. So the very words out of your mouth, Pharaoh, are now being used against you. As a matter of fact, in Joel's second chapter, Joel 2:20, it is Yahweh describing the locust as his army. When Pharaoh described their multiplication like swarms, okay, he described it as though they were a curse to the Egyptians. That's why they're so disgusting. They need to be destroyed. Okay, so everything, okay, that Pharaoh said about them came upon them. Now, here's what's funny. I'll make you laugh now. With the locusts came in from what direction? The east. Where did the Israelites originally come from? Canaan, the east. Okay, so you call my people locusts? Here come the locusts from the very land, okay, that they came from. He brings in those locusts. Now, the locusts also represent an army, right? When Pharaoh, okay, relents and Moses sends the locusts off, that great army, where does he send that army? West into the Red Sea, where they are drowned. The very route that the Israelites wind up going into the Red Sea is where he sends the locusts. Only his people that were called swarms of locusts go across dry land, but the army that accused them gets what? Drowned. The destroyer that accused them got drowned in the Red Sea, just like the locusts did. So God was showing us about what was going to happen. But when we don't recognize symbolism, the symbolism behind that, okay? So the Egyptians accused the Israelites, who were from the east, of being like swarms of insects who would consume everything and then leave. Remember, that's what they said. So what does God do? Bring in locusts from the east that consumed everything. Your fear, the words that you spoke out of your mouth came upon you. You use my people to build your economy. I'm gonna use them symbolically to do what? Destroy it. Destroy it. Okay, now. Pharaoh blinded his eyes to not humble themselves and look up to God, bow down to the ground, look up to God. The locust, what, darkened the earth once again so he could not see, and the sea down, and the darkness once again, okay, darkened so he couldn't see up. Okay, promises made, promises kept. Okay, promises made, promises kept. All right. Hallelujah. Remember what he had said, and that darkness leading up to the firstborn. If you don't let my firstborn go, I'm going to kill yours. Remember, they killed the beasts. There must be, oh, you don't hear what I'm saying. People want God to get involved. You really want to get God involved with reparations? I'm going to do what Aretha Franklin, you better think. You better think about what you're trying to do. Okay, you better think. Okay, so today, said this was absolutely awesome. The reason for the plagues, the reason God did everything that he did with these last plagues was leading up to where he would let the people go at the Passover. It's at Passover where I will pass over you, put the blood on the door. The house becomes like a womb. The children exit through the womb, and a nation is born in freedom. Born in freedom. That's why you need to be born again. Okay, we were slaves to sin. Now we are free. Okay, now we are free. And guess what? We have victory against our enemies. If we understand God's pattern in His, the way He brought us out of Egypt is the way He will bring us out today. So that, like Moses said, you will see the reward of the wicked with your own eyes. He said, come on. Okay, he that what hideth in the secret place of the Most High, abide in the shadow of Shaddai. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So let me say something. Each of you today, I'm going to tell you right now, has been empowered with a revelation of what Yah is about to do in your lives. That's why I say you go to work and they have those oppressive people. You just smile, start smiling, okay? Just start smiling. Because the harder the oppression, the more an indication God is about to bring you out. God is about to bring you out. There's about to be a change. There's about to be a change in your time, a change in time. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And you will see the reward of the wicked, every single pain, okay, He will inflict upon your enemy. Guess what? In mercy, because He gave them the opportunity. Let me tell you, He gave them the opportunity. And people don't believe that. Oh, no, Yeshua, gentle, meek, and mild. You better read that book of Revelation because he's throwing mountains on people, okay, by then. Okay, they would blaspheme, no problem, stoning them. He'd pick up Mount Everest and throw it at them. And what are they doing? Trying to hide in caves, trying to hide because that great day of the Lord is upon them. So don't tell me that Yeshua is not the same today as He was yesterday. The same God that brought us out of Egypt the first time is the same God that is going to deliver us this time. The same one, the same exact one. Hallelujah. And we will see the reward of the wicked with our own eyes. We will see it. So let me tell you something. God has given the nations and a chance to repent. But should they continue in the wickedness that they are in, it's only going to get worse. The plagues will only get worse. The oppression, the economy, we can't seem to get the economy right. It has nothing to do with what is going on in Washington. It has everything to do with what is going on in the hearts of the people in this nation. And until we get the hearts right, there will be no lasting relief. You understand what I'm saying here? However, we are His witnesses. We can look at this scripture and see it manifesting before our very eyes. Before our very eyes. Okay. And know that Yeshua is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And forever. And I say, just like He said in Jeremiah, He has plans for you. He knows the plans He has for you. And those plans are of shalom and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope. But He's not going to do it with this ugliness that we have in our hearts. We learned, what did we learn on Thursday? There's going to be a remnant. You got to listen to Thursday, Renee Boise. You got to listen to Thursday. There's going to be a remnant.
We heard it.
We did.
Oh, you did? Okay, okay,
good. Good Friday. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, there's going to be a remnant. Okay, a remnant that He is going to bring out. And by a showing of hands, do I have anybody here who is the remnant of Israel that is about to be brought out? Hallelujah. 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 All right, all right, all right, all right. Oh, ha, 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 ha. Marcia, okay, I'm going to use you to pray. Pray us on out. You've been on since the beginning. So I'm going to use you to pray us on out today.
Praise God. Whatever you got, Pastor, you need to give us an IV of what you have in you. Because I'm telling you, it's like a shockwave. But praise God. Thank God. Hallelujah. Father, we want to thank you, Yeshua. We want to thank you for your blessings. You're the God of Abraham, Father Isaac, and Jacob. Hallelujah. We bless you today on your Shabbat, your day that you have made, oh Father. Thank you, Yeshua, Lord, for God, for keeping us, for providing for us, Lord God, for making a way when it seems like no other way, Yeshua, for giving us health and strength, Lord God, for your grace and your mercy, for your loving kindness, Yeshua. You are our rock, you are our shield, you are our buckler, Lord God. You're the rose of Sharon, Yeshua. You are the lily of the valley, hallelujah. You sit high and you look down low. You are ruler of this universe, Yeshua, hallelujah. The stars, the sun, the moon, they worship you. The trees worship you, Yeshua. The animals worship you. You said, let everything that have breath praise ye the Lord. Hallelujah. We thank you, Yeshua, for our pastor. We thank you for your word. We thank you for your teaching and instructions, the Torah, Father. For you, Father, we shall listen and obey, Father. Hallelujah. That we stand on your word, Father. For Lord God, your word, your rock, oh God, and all around is sinking sand, Yeshua. Hallelujah. That we must stand, Lord God, with Yeshua, Lord Father, that we must, oh God, walk out and be a blessing to others, Lord God, that our light may shine, Yeshua, hallelujah. We may see the things around this world, Lord God, but that we must not fear, Father, hallelujah. For we see, oh Father, your prophecy, we see your word living before our eyes, Yeshua, Lord God. And we ask you to continue to bless your people, Lord God. Continue to bless the members of Hebrew Institute and their family, Lord God. Continue to bless Sierra Leone, Father, and the children, Lord God, and those who are running the place, Lord God. Continue to provide for them, Lord God, that we may be a blessing to others, Yeshua. Hallelujah. And we ask, oh God, for your people, Lord God, to give them strength, Lord God, to heal their bodies that are sick, Lord God. In the name of Yeshua, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. All right. Well, since you give us a nugget, Marcia.
Oh, well, I had to make a comment. I put a chat on there. I said, preach, Pastor, in caps, because it was just awesome. The word, I'm telling you, I just felt like a shockwave coming through my computer. But the word was so profound. I kind of wrote a couple of things on here. You were talking about, you know, sometimes what people demonize is what they fear. And we see that a lot of times. It's like, when they can't manipulate you, they'll try to demonize. And we see that, obviously, you know, what's going on now. And it was so prevalent. And I thank you, Pastor, for bringing that out. Sometimes we don't understand things that's going on, but we just go back to the word and we see the Torah. We see the word just living out before our eyes. And those were things that just like stuck with me. And you were talking about Pharaoh and how Moses, Pharaoh wasn't the same Pharaoh that Moses knew from the beginning, which was like, yeah, that's right. You know, it was a different Pharaoh. So that was a, you know, an eye opener. And I just thank you all and just blessings to you all at Hebrew Institute.
Praise Yah, praise Yah. Okay, let's continue. Aquila next.
Okay.
Oh, you're muted again. There you go.
Since you came to Detroit, let me take it a little further. Bozy, you bad a thing? What you trying to do to me? Try to set your own mind free.
Yeah, that's it.
You know, Aretha, she was on time. And what you were saying, think about what you're trying to do against God's people. And you use that thinking to try to set yourself free. That's what Aretha said. And you know, our enemies got to learn, like you say, and be taught, if they'll listen, what they're doing to the people of the living Yah. And so this message today not only set me free, it set me free to help others get free.
All right, that's what it's about.
It's real timely.
That's it.
It's on the clock. It's on the calendar. Praise Yah. Bless all my brothers and sisters.
All right. All right.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. I'll tell you what, Brad and Jenny.
Yeah, I don't have a whole lot, or I don't have anything to say yet, but it was good though. I like how, you know, how you even said in the beginning of last year and this year, you talk about, told me things I haven't seen before and that kind of stuff. Like every time we go over this, like the plagues and, you know, the Torah portions, we see something that we never seen before. Like it comes a little closer in, and you get a little closer in on stuff, and you start to learn stuff about why he did stuff like the plagues and how it relates, and it just opens your eyes even wider to kind of, like, you know, see the details and what God did. So it's just kind of awesome to learn that and to see stuff a little bit closer that you never seen before. So
amen, amen. Miss Jenny?
I mean, like Brad, like I'm ready to pass out on sofa right now. Like the I don't know what it was about the locust specifically that just really hit me, and it's just like, it's mind blowing.
All right.
One more quick thing too is when you hear about this, you know, story here with Moses, it kind of reminds me of also Elijah, mm-hmm. and what he did, like, and when he you know had a competition between their gods and Yahweh to rain down fire on the altar, and ultimately, of course, you know, Yahweh is the highest God, and you know, Yahweh won, you know. So, you know, it kind of reminds me of that too.
Amen, amen, amen. All right, Katrina. Up, you're muted. You're still muted. There you go.
Okay, Shabbat Shalom. What I got from my nugget is that God said, if you won't let my firstborn go, I'll kill your firstborn. And also the fact that Pharaoh would not let his people go. And then so, you know, the father said, since you drowned my babies, I'm going to drown your people in the Red Sea. So it was like they would drown in the water, just like the babies were drowning in the water. And so to me, that's measure for measure, because he was like, you killed mine in the water, so I'm going to kill yours in the water. Mm. And it's going to be like covered up.
Right.
Yes, ma'am.
All right. Very good. Very good. Very good. Georgia, are you? You're on my mind.
Hey. Thank you, Pastor Israel, as always. You can hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay. Well, I'm getting ready for work, but I had to stay on. I couldn't just leave. telling my son about, you know, how Yah said, you know, we will see the reward of the wicked here in this life, and we'll see it. And I'm just looking about this place and seeing how many places are in need of employees. No one is wanting to stay on jobs. I mean, or our place of business, they're short staff all over, and it's all over the country. They're not paying people the wages that they're supposed to pay them. They're treating people terrible. So now the ball is in the employees' court. So people can go and find jobs and bid for what they want. I'm seeing that, and I'm saying, look at God. They ill-treat people on their jobs, don't pay them properly, and now they're begging people to work. So I'm just seeing God's hand in this, you know? So thank Amen. You. Thank you.
Amen. 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 All right. All right. Let me see. Hermine. Oh, where'd you go? Nope, you're not, you took your picture off. Okay, while she's trying to get that done, Connie.
Woo, that was a good, wonderful word. You was on fire. That extra 15 minutes was all right by me. That was all right by me, I'm telling you. One of the things that really stuck with me was that the more things change, the more they stay the same. That was my title for your message today. I'll put that down because mm-hmm. It's true. What's happening then is really, it's happening right now. And as they say in the church, I wouldn't take nothing for my journey right now, going through the Torah with Pastor Israel. Wonderful word, wonderful word. I mean, I hunger and thirst after righteousness on a daily basis. And I tell Mr. Turner, every morning I take 350 milligrams of attitude and gratitude and 6 ounces of humility. And that's how I start my day and I keep it going. Thank you so much. Wonderful word. This week. Wonderful word.
Praise God. Praise God. All right. All right. Next in line, Renee and Boise.
Amen. Amen. Shabbat shalom, everybody. Shalom. Wow. I love it that we were brought out to bring others in. And of course, promises kept are promises made with Daniel. End time concealed, revelation end time revealed. Yeshua is no joke.
No joke.
And I love the attention to detail. If there's something that's missing out of scripture, watch as well as pray, look, pay attention. Because it is any type of word, any type of doing is to move you away from who he is. The same one in the end is the same one in the beginning. It's the same one with us now. Same power, same presence. Woo! It was just awesome. And I said, oh my gosh, oh, this is without vitamins, power to the people. It was awesome. All right, babe.
Again, it was powerful. It was thought-provoking. It was spiritual-provoking. The thing I wanted to also ask you, it's just something that came in my spirit when I was listening to you, and I also was reading in Exodus 9:14 and verses 14-19, as especially Exodus 12, verses 29. It talks about judgment. Now, you talk about the judgment of the economy and Pharaoh and his people that refused to obey Yahweh. The thing I'm saying, and it talks about, especially in chapter 12, verse 29, it talks about how when a death angel came to destroy the firstborn on the throne of Pharaoh, also came into the dungeons, to the captives. And I was wondering that not only was Pharaoh and them destroyed, but also was there Israelites who still in doubt or in rebellion against the Most High also stood with Pharaoh at that time, even though majority of Israel did stand in obedience to Yahweh. But was there, when they say captives, was there anyone on the Hebrew side that also said, hey, we don't believe in God ourselves and we're gonna stand in defiance? And they ended up also getting judged with that.
See, where the Bible isn't clear, you could guess. However, remember the Israelites were instructed to do what? Put the blood on the doorpost, the blood on the doorpost. No. Okay, so if you were an Israelite and you didn't circumcise and you didn't put the blood on the doorpost, your house experienced death that night.
Right.
See, that is why you could have a mixed multitude coming out. Because you could have been an Egyptian that did what? Circumcised, ate the blood on the doorpost and went out. And you could have been an Israelite that didn't do that. So you experienced death. It's the same thing. When you think of, I want you to think about this. When they came out of Babylon, most of Judah stayed in Babylon. Mm-hmm. A very small remnant came out when it was time to come out.
Right.
That's right. Just the way we roll. But where the Bible isn't clear, you can only just think.
Right.
Just think about such. But this was, you know, very clear as far as what he's saying is that everywhere, there was no place that was spared. If you were a firstborn, okay, even if you were in the firstborn in the prison there, okay, you did not, okay, you experienced loss, okay? Right. But how do you bet? There was probably someone saying, hey, can you go get some lamb blood so I can put it on myself? Okay. It wouldn't surprise me if that happened. Okay. Be circumcised. Okay. Y'all ain't playing with you fools. Okay.
Wake up call.
You can only imagine. But the whole thing is where it says, for there was no house in Egypt, for there was no house where there was not someone dead.
Right.
That is something. And here's the whole thing. Remember when we talked about the darkness, how they probably came in the dark night and stole the babies?
Right.
Well, here we have in that very verse, in the middle of the night, Yah struck down and took their firstborn.
Ooh, measure for measure.
Measure for measure, I can see. They came in at night. You know why they're coming at night? Because you can't see. There's nobody to tell. Hey, who was it? I couldn't see him. It was the dark of night.
Right, right.
Wow. Or witness this or anything. And then threw the baby in the Nile so that there was a cover up of crime. Next day, all you hear is screaming in the middle of the night. Where's my child? Someone got my child. And so very measure for measure, measure for measure. But the eye opener for me was, wait a minute, these were not the same Egyptians that were in the middle or the beginning of Egypt. This was a whole generation.
Yes.
Okay, that this happened with. So as it was then, the same thing today. You're not going to use that same excuse.
Come on. Amen.
All right. All right, Cindy, I know you, you're just wave to us because I know your microphone is okay. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All right, Leroy, you're up next.
Well, I gotta find the mute button. I'm quite sure, Pastor, you look out the window, you probably have manna falling all over the out of the sky. Over there. That was an amazing message. I mean, the world needs to hear that. That was so awesome on so many levels. So educational on so many levels. And it shows how the Israelites in Egypt, and in comparison to the Israelites in America, it's the same experience that they're having. It's the same Pharaoh that's saying that these people is a security threat. Look at them, there it is, there that. Let's deal shrewdly with them. Let's set up a system where we can destroy them. They have the Abrahamic covenant. They're multiplying. It's too many of them. They're mightier than we. And it's the same system that the Israelites suffered up under Pharaoh in Egypt. It's the same type and shadow that's going on in America. And we're seeing the same results. We're seeing the same thing that's happening with the economy. We're seeing the plagues coming through. And it's time for, that's that small window for mercy, okay? Turn it around. And when it's not going to get turned around, like it says, it's going to be even worse. You know, it just been, and you know, it hits different when you're the recipient of what Pharaoh is doing.
Yeah.
You know, so when you understand what's going on and see that the enemy role is to kill, steal, and destroy all the time. So you don't have to look at a person as looking at their skin color. You can look at their characteristics and see who Satan is. What is Satan's job? Kill, steal, and destroy. Who kills, steal, and destroy? There's your Satan. So now you see that even with what the Israelites has experienced in America, all kind of injustices, sterilizing women, shedding of innocent blood, poisoning the water system, the schools poor education in the schools. Let's take Sharp out of schools because these people are master builders. Everything that they can do to try to destroy the people of God is in place. But guess what? The Abrahamic covenant is still here and his people is still multiplied. So it just, I have too much to say. I can't get it all out. There are so many things inside of me. So I think that was a great message. And I'll also say with when you was talking about amen, some people don't say amen because they're saying it's a god, because there was an Egyptian sun god named Amun. And also the name was Amun. And it was Amen Ra. So there was an Egyptian sun god with that similar name. So that's why some people say, oh, when you say amen, you giving honor to a sun god. But as we've seen throughout the study and the Blue Letter Bible, that's totally not the case.
Mm-hmm. All right.
No, that was very rich. I can go run a couple of miles now.
All right. Let's go up to Lena. Lena, unmute yourself.
Hey.
All right.
Hello, everybody. Adi's God. And I never really knew him when I was growing up. And but my grandfather was very, to me, a wise man. And he taught us kids what it means to be in this world. We're not in this world. The creator of the world is going to come back. He didn't even read the Bible before. So he taught us to treat people like you would like to be treated. And that's difficult to me. And also the fact that you can't fight something that's bigger than you, meaning that America was seized by those the people that came over from Europe. And he said, just stand by and love them. And that seems biblical to me now. Can you hear me, Pastor?
Yes, yes.
Anyway, it sounds so familiar to me. Treat other people like you would like to be treated. Treat the animals kindly. Don't use them for your own profit. Things like that. So thank you for your message, and it brings out back a lot of memories for me. And it's you that's bringing the word out to life to me. Thank you very much.
Praise the Most High. Praise the Most High. All right, Ed.
Life is like a box of chocolates. You never know what you're going to get. This was quite interesting. I see now that Pharaoh could not repent. Whether God hardened his heart, he couldn't. There's no way he could repent because he was God on earth. And when he died, he considered himself still to be a God. So he could not repent no matter what happened. And I did not realize until you brought it out a little earlier that his servants are the ones that went and got Moses that final time. And then after that, Pharaoh says, I don't want to see your face again ever anymore. So that was it. But Pharaoh considered himself a God. They considered Pharaoh to be a God. But we don't see that in the way we read it. But Pharaoh considered himself to be a God. He considered himself to be the representative of Amun-Ra on earth. He was the sun god on earth. He was a living God. So once you start looking at it through the Egyptians' perspective, there was no way he could give in to Moses. There's just no way he could do it. And the final part was the part you mentioned, that generation that was living was the one that profited off of the backs of the Hebrew children. That generation that first subjected them were gone. That was the second generation that was there, which was very interesting. But something we should learn, a man should learn, that when you dehumanize or demonize someone, that makes it easier to destroy them. We've seen that pattern in history over and over and over again. And hopefully we don't go down that pattern in this country. We pray.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Miriam.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Awesome teaching. Pride is deadly. and how God used all the Egyptian gods, which were all the plagues, and how he destroyed everything. And what was I going to say? Pharaoh was trying to save face, and he never could. And so you can't go against God's people because he sees everything, and vengeance is his, and he's going to take care of us, and we just have to trust him. No matter what happens in our lives, he's on our side and he's got our backs. And that was just an awesome teaching. And how the whole world actually saw this happen was an amazing thing. It wasn't just the people that were there. The whole world was shown who God really is. And there's only one God, and it's him.
Amen. 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 You know, and that was the big lesson. Everybody was looking at what was going on in Egypt. Everyone looked at what was going on in Egypt. Okay. And that's why later on when the Israelites, remember in the book of Joshua, when Joshua sent the spies out, what did Rahab said? Our hearts were trembling with fear. Our hearts were trembling with fear because everybody saw what was going on. Everybody saw the most powerful nation of the world, okay, be brought to its knees. Okay, not only its leader, but those that followed the leader, that followed that leader, okay, at that time, that led the people away from God, you know. So, you know, today was eye-opening, a lot of eye-opening on me, even with the New Testament scriptures. That's what was a big surprise for me. I never looked at that. Oh, wait a minute, there's God fears. Oh, wow, 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 wow. You know, so, you know, that's why there are certain things that Yah will do when we're all together that you don't see when you're by yourself. You hear somebody else read something, it can spark something in you that you never saw before. So that's one reason why when we come together and I have different people read is because the different voices, they you know, inspire you. They trigger something within you that you didn't hear before until you heard someone else read it. So don't despise just reading the scriptures. It's very, very important. Oh, well, guys, I am going to get ready to go today. Alina, you know, Tom, who is over our pancake breakfast, he's having a birthday celebration later on tonight. He's 80 years old. Listen, 80 years old and still going scuba diving and everything. This man is, I mean, it's just amazing. I mean, absolutely amazing. He travels to Cancun and with a bunch of them from the Rotary, and they go scuba diving and, you know, all of that kind of stuff. Very, still very athletic. And he's over the pancake breakfast that we do. And he is a big benefactor of the ministry also, you know, of the ministry and everything. And so I'm going to go and celebrate his 80th birth tonight, you know. So I'll give him regards from everyone. So anyway, all right, may Yahweh bless you and keep you. May Yahweh make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May Yahweh lift up his countenance upon you and give you his shalom in the name of Yeshua HaMashiach. Shalom, shalom. All right, guys, let me see. Okay, Brad, I guess you can stop the recording.